Hey everybody, Pastor Doug here. I want to welcome you to another session of Pastor Doug's Midweek Bible Study, and really excited to join you today, and thank you for taking the time to tune in. I've been doing these messages and stuff in these series of meetings with you, and generally, or most of the time, I think I have my ministry partner, Doug Puren, Pastor Doug, to be a part of the group with me. And again, he's supposedly flying. Well, we tease him a lot. I tease him, I got to tell you, and you have to tease him when you see him. I tease him that he's really not a pilot, that he works for TSA and he's just a check-in guy. And I get such a kick out of it because he doesn't know what to say. He just gives me that little bit of a grin and he laughs a little bit. But I enjoy teasing him. And I know my brother would always think, believe it or not, I tease Daryl too. I know that might be a surprise to you, but Daryl would always say, you only tease me because you like me. And I think that's generally true. And I sure think a lot of Pastor Tall Doug, and he's a really, really great person. I mean, as good as he may seem to you, he's that and then some. He's just a really good guy. And I love him dearly, as I do my brother and everything. So I do tease a lot. But yeah, he's flying right now. And I just wanted to also, I hope he's tuning in, as my buddy Tim Osborne is feeling a lot better after his episode with his heart and some things going on. And he should be home really soon. I'm so pleased to tell you that. Thank you so much for all your prayers for him. And the prayers for lots of different people. There's lots of things going on. If you're not part of our prayer chain, you might want to do that, because we sent out some prayer requests for today already. There's a lot going on in our large church family, and we love each other, and we want to be praying to help each other and be careful. This past week, my message, I've been doing a message series on the life of Daniel, and talking this week about when Daniel and his value system, his beliefs, what he thought he knew was being challenged because he was taken captive by the Babylonians. In fact, King Nebuchadnezzar took over the Israelites and took 25% of the people and held them captive and started to retrain them, and took the elite and best looking of the group and started to train them and transform them into his powerhouse of thinkers, getting the smartest people that the Israelites had and made them special in his staff and on his team in the palace. And Daniel was one of those guys. Just a remarkable story. In fact, I encourage you, if you got some time, to get your Bible out and read the book of Daniel. It's a pretty interesting and exciting life that Daniel had. But anyway, that's what the study is about. And this past week, I talked about when your education is being questioned, when your beliefs are being challenged. And I'll tell you what, folks, I don't know if you're noticing, and maybe that would be the best thing to do, is maybe you don't watch the news. Maybe you don't follow anything that's going on. And sometimes for me, and oftentimes Robin and I are thinking about, you know, maybe we shouldn't watch so much. Maybe it would be nice not to know what in the world's going on, because some of it's very scary. Folks, we're witnessing. Now, understand what's happening. We are witnessing a transformation within our society that's actually taking place. And here's what's troubling to me, because I gave some statistics in the lesson that I gave this week. I was talking about the number of different types of religions in the world and how dominant the Christian's faith is, belief in God, and in reference to the small voice that perhaps the atheists have. And it's, I guess, recorded in statistics today, about 3% of our country are atheists, but yet they seem to have the loudest voice. Why is that? And I look at my life, and I have to tell you, I've had folks approach me time to time and ask me about running for, you know, state representative or congressional place. And it's very honorable to be asked that. Say, hey, you know, you'd make a good congressman or whatever. And I think about it, I think, oh yeah, you know, that might be fun. I like it. I enjoy the debate. I enjoy trying to convince people to think a certain way. I mean, that's kind of what my life is as a pastor, sharing information. And I think about it, but then at the same time, I think, I don't want to get into that mess. I don't want to get into the nasty partisan thinking that's going on in our world. And so I think quite often a lot of good people maybe, and I don't know if I classify myself in there, but maybe I will for this example. Good people don't want to get down and dirty and get into that mess. They don't want to be open for ridicule. They don't want to have fingers pointed at them. I can remember years ago, many years ago, oh, over 20 years ago, I guess it is now, I was on the Blue Mountain School Board. And it was fun. It was a prestigious thing to be on, and certainly not a paid position, but it was an elected position. And I got into a lot of those meetings, and I was kind of surprised at the pushback of just general honest, balanced thinking. One of the things that always bothered me was they had budget time, and I remember this very clearly. I'll tell you this, try to get onto my point. But the amount of income that the school board had at that time was right around 22 million, I think it was. I could be wrong on those numbers. It was right around 22 million. So then it was the budget time proposal for budgets, and we're working on that. This is my first budget in the school board, so I was kind of excited on what's going on, and I was on one of the committees, and we're talking back and forth. And the budget was presented, and they were requesting a budget of 28 million. And I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, wait a minute. They're asking for 28 million. I thought they said they had income from taxes of 22 million. And I brought that up, and I was looked at like I was from outer space. And they said, well, what do you mean? And I said, well, how can you spend 28 when you only have 22? I mean, our government does it all the time. Well, we're going to raise the taxes. And I said, I think we ought to try to spend what we have. I mean, we have to do that at home. Why shouldn't we have to do that? So guess what? The next week, a couple weeks went by, they came back with another budget proposal. It dropped it down to 25,000 or 25 million. And I thought, wow, that was kind of quick. You went 3 million dropped off in just a couple of weeks. How'd you do that? And they went on to explain what they did, but still, and I still said, well, I get it, and you're getting better and closer. Long story short, eventually, they got back to the amount of money that they actually had coming in for the budget. And so we learned that that's what you do, but our society doesn't think that way. We hear so much on the political side, and I don't want to get political. It's ugly and it's not nice, and both sides are wrong most of the time. It's just sad where we've stooped to. We look at what's happening in our colleges, what they're teaching our children. I can remember going to school, and you said the Pledge of Allegiance. We had even a bow your head time, to sometimes say the Lord's Prayer, and it wasn't a big deal. It wasn't frowned upon. Now, even pledging to our flag is questioned. Who are these people that are doing this? Who's thinking that that's okay? And why do good, God-fearing, country-loving people allow it? Why are we sitting back and saying nothing? You know why? You don't want the protesters standing out in front of your house, picketing you. You don't want somebody coming up and yelling at you while you're sitting at Hoss's trying to have lunch. We have learned to be quiet in our beliefs, both in our faith and politically, because we don't want to get shouted down. We don't want to get fingers pointed at us. And I want to tell you something, I get it. I understand. You've been at parties, you've been at settings, and you know when some folks are there and they don't think like you do and they don't believe like you do. And man, they seem to be the first ones to jump down your throat when they get a chance. Well, I want to tell you something. Sometimes, and I think the times are now, where we got to speak up. And I want to give you a tip on what I think we should do. We need to begin in prayer. We need to begin by going to God about what to do and how to do. Kind of take this concept in your head. We're going to go to God for, God, we want to speak up. We want to represent you. We want to stand for you. We want people to know how we feel. But we just don't want to go off without any planning. We don't want to go off without any thinking. We want to do it right. And your word says we should come to you with everything, even the things we think are small things, even with the things we think that aren't life and death. And I think this is one of them. So here's what I'm challenging you to do. Today, begin today, and start talking to God about how can we stand up for our beliefs. How can we stand up for what we believe in and believing in you, God? What ways can we stand up for what's right within our country, in our society? Stand up for protecting our families and our children and those values that we hold so dearly. You know, the big thing right now is the abortion issue. And it's complicated. I get it. It's very complicated. But there's people's lives at stake. Society right now is at stake. And what are we to do as believers? As believers, we are to pray. The power of prayer is so strong. It can accomplish so many things. In fact, this week in my message, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that. That I think as believers, we miss it. We miss a big, powerful resource that we have that's unlimited. There's no limits to the prayer that you can offer to a loving God. Why don't we? Do you ever ask yourself that? Do you pray enough? Would you be embarrassed if there was a calculator, say a reading on your forehead, that had recorded how many minutes or hours you prayed each week to date? I know we go to our computers and we look at our bank accounts and what money's been spent to date. What if there was a register of how much prayer time you spent to date? Would that be embarrassing to you for other people to see it? I challenge you to increase that prayer life and that prayer time. And I want to tell you, when you do that, and if you do that, you will see remarkable changes in your life. And they'll probably begin in you. Probably will begin in how you feel and how you think. You know, you have people in your lives. We all have people in our lives that we enjoy being around. They're just fun to be around. And they're a good influence. And maybe they're successful people. I know as I was growing up, I tried to have some friends, and I had some mentors out there that I went to that were successful business people. They were just good at it because that's where my ambitions were at that time until God changed me. But I spent time with them, and I talked with them, and I asked them how they thought and what they did, and I just wanted to hear that. And when I would leave there, I felt like I gained some confidence in the business side of things. Can you imagine what influence spending time with God, the creator of all things, could have on your life? Think about that. How he could change you. Right now, as you're listening, many of you have some hurts going on. Some of you have some illness. Maybe that's personally attacking you and your body. Or maybe you're watching a loved one suffer. Or maybe you did watch them suffer for a long time and now they're gone. Maybe you can't stand to get the mail because that bill's going to be in there. And they're going to pile up. And it's frustrating because they're there. I know they're there, but I don't have the money to pay them. Or that relationship is gone sideways. And you don't even know how it happened. Or you lost that job and that income source that you had and you depended on for so long. Now what? What are they going to do now? Or maybe you have that wayward child that just seems to always get into the wrong things. Or maybe there's a family member that's battling addiction. You're scared. Lots of people are losing their lives because of that. And are you going to be the next one that loses somebody? Guys, there's never been a better time. There's never been better moments
for us to depend on God. I've learned in my life to depend on Him, to go to Him with what's ailing me, what's troubling me. I wish I were better at it. I wish I was somebody that could pray these beautiful prayers that people just marvel at, but I'm not. But I know how to talk to God from my heart. And that's what I would encourage you to do today. Let's take our country, our society, our families, our relationships, our finances, our health, to the Creator of all things. I hope you can do that today. I want you to know something. I love you guys. I think very highly of you. Very honored to be your pastor. Sorry for being a little emotional today, but this is a big deal to me. It's time that we get to God and we turn this world, our society, and our government over to Him. I love you. Have a great day, and I sure hope to see you Sunday morning. God bless you.